We're here.
Here we go. Hey guys.
Making a video. It's already started. You're gonna sit over there.
That's where we're doing it?
Perfect. Yeah. I'm gonna sit very far away from you.
Okay.
Okay, come this way. I think it'll be easier.
Okay.
You ready for this?
Yeah.
So my notes?
Yeah, I didn't.
Email?
I didn't read them.
Of course not.
This is a.
Yeah, you can put your bag down. You know, like behind the scenes is always in front of the scenes here at tastytrade.
Yeah.
This is all part of the plan.
Okay.
You know?
All right.
Here we are.
I'm ready. You got all your questions, you got all your stuff.
Not really, I'm just gonna wait.
I don't care what you do. Wing away. What am I looking at? The camera or you?
You looking at me.
Okay.
Okay. You ready?
Yeah. Fire away. So that's kind of a little bit of an intro. So you're listening to day one. This is our official launch. My name is Tom. Across from me is Tony. Sara's to my right. And Sara's a comedy writer and a comedian, actress.
We have Vanetta coming in to read the news with us.
And Tony and I are
the rest of the day.
Tony and I are ex-floor traders and a bunch of other stuff throughout our careers. So hopefully you'll enjoy listening to us for the next 7 or 8 years. We plan to be on for a long time. And we're going to have a little fun for the rest of our lives.
Absolutely.
All right, we'll be back in 2 minutes. You're listening to Get Tasted.
Well, the name tastytrade, first of all, so a little backstory on tastytrade.
Nobody bakes a cake as tasty as a tasty cake.
It's 4-1, and Riemsdyk scores for a case of tasty cakes.
Tasty cakes comes from Philly. It's a classic Philly snack cake.
How do you know they were from Philadelphia?
Come on, I know the history of all cakes. You know, right.
And you saw the tasty cake there.
I'm like, beautiful. This is a beautiful thing. The tasty cake, imported from Philadelphia.
When did you know that it was imported from Philadelphia?
Later in life.
Where'd you have your first tasty cake?
You're pushing it.
I am.
Well, remember, at that point, I'd never been to Philadelphia. My first trip to Philadelphia was in either a freshman or a sophomore in college. I had a buddy that went to Penn. And I also went to one of the craziest concerts of all time, which was an outdoor Yes concert in the old, I think it was RFK. It was either JFK or RFK. It was one of the old stages they tore down. And then during the day, it was so hot. We had no food, no drink. And at night, it was so cold, it was bonfires. It was one of the weirdest days ever. It was like a 12-hour concert. It was brutal. Yeah, down in Philadelphia, couldn't afford food other than tasty cakes. We couldn't find the cheesesteak place we wanted, so we ended up with tasty cakes. So I thought of the name tastytrade because I've always liked tasty cakes, tasty freeze, figured I'd go along with the food theme. And so I bought the domain tastytrade.com. We were building this web-based trading platform at the time for Thinkorswim, and I was going to call it tastytrade. And so TP and I started working on, you know, some different, we both love the name tastytrade and we started working on it.
I want you to think back to when you first told TP.
TP is not gonna ask me what are the origins of this. You know, the guy has two master's degrees in Latin. He didn't give a crap about the origins of anything.
I remember every blessed thing that anybody says, where stuff is. It is a curse. But I remember this stuff. And the least important stuff, I remember the most. Hence, I remember tastytrade. It was about late 2008, early 2009, I think, and we were in Las Vegas doing a trader expo. At night, we'd take everybody, and there were about maybe 12 or 13 people with us, took them out to dinner at the old Palms Casino. It was the Nine Steakhouse in the Palms. They put us kind of in a back area with a table big enough for our group. And Tom and I were sitting across from each other. And he looks at me and says, hey, what do you think of the name tastytrade? Yeah, got a ring to it. Sounds good.
Oh, you would get Tom and TP together. It was this escalation of crazy ideas that you really weren't sure where it was going to end up.
Tom definitely brought it up while we were still working at Thinkorswim, fascinated with the presentation of the combination of the two words, right? Tasty and trade definitely have a little bit of spirit to them. I ended up generating some motion graphics with sort of like an animation that had tastytrade in it. Yeah, I spent like an hour or two like just throwing together some stuff where the logo would like drop down and like a little sparkle would come up.
Tom sat at his desk, was open. There were no doors on Tom's office. Anybody could walk up to him, talk to him. And he said to us, okay, gather round. And so we walk up to see what Woody had built. It was fun to see, but it was also more like at that time, okay, I gotta get back to work.
There was another name that he really wanted. He said, have Tommy, my wife, have Tommy get online and buy this name because it's genius. It's brilliant, we're gonna use it at some point in time. I said, sure, how do you know it's available? So he's like, I think it's available. I said, what's the name? Swimming in Butter. I said, my guess is that is available.
I just like the domain name. I bought it on GoDaddy for $9.95. Bought it at $9.95 with a company credit card. I should have bought it my own credit card, but I wasn't thinking, because I thought we were gonna use it as a web-based platform. I bought it with the company credit card, so it was owned by Thinkorswim.
So we had a long list of domain names, and this one just took flight. This one actually started to take shape much earlier than I think most people know about.
When we sold to TD Ameritrade and went through the whole process, as I'm negotiating my own personal deal with Fred, he's like, what do you want now?
When a company comes in and acquires another company, generally they're buying all the assets, all the liabilities, you're buying the equity of the company. There was one small piece that Tom wanted to make sure was carved out.
So he's bargaining with me for money and compensation and all this kind of stuff. So I go, there's one thing I really want. And he's like, you're not getting to use the private jet. No, I wasn't even gonna ask for that. He said, what do you want? I go, we got this domain that I bought on the company credit card, but I want it. It's called tastytrade. He goes, what are you gonna use tastytrade for? I go, I'm gonna use it for this web-based platform. He goes, not on my dead body. No way are we calling a TD Ameritrade platform tastytrade. He goes, how much did you pay for it? I go, $9.95. He goes, and that's all you want is a $9.95 website in addition to whatever I negotiated. But he's like, I give you this website, we're done. And I go, yep. He goes, it's yours.
Woo! Get tasty, free market. Come on, you know it, can you feel it? We got some things to talk about. Free market, it's early, but not too early. Come on, wake up now. Pour that coffee down your throat hole. It's hot. Now you got a hole in your throat.
We're all following is changing the financial future. So, without further ado, Mr. Tom Sosnoff!
As I had been on the road for 10 straight years, I knew the value of content marketing. I was the only CEO in this entire industry of finance that's been on the road for 10 years, just talking to people. I also knew what I liked to listen to. If I turned on the radio, I wanted to hear, for example, in Chicago, I wanted to listen to Steve Dahl.
The man who single-handedly was responsible for a riot at Comiskey Park. You don't want to be known
no,
as a
No, I'm ashamed of myself.
No, don't be. It's not you. It's the people who ran out on that field that should take the responsibility.
I took blame. As a matter of fact, I went home and after the alleged riot, and I went back home to Los Angeles to my mom's house and had her spank me soundly for 2 weeks.
I wanted to listen to the crazy sports nuts like Mike North, you know, who cracked me up,
you know, sitting in my car driving home.
Can you imagine coaching for your career the Atlanta Hawks and you're Phil Jackson? You would have been fired after 2 years. You think they're going to listen to him? He can't talk. We're going to read a book and we're going to be on the plane and then we're going to do the triangle.
Well, then why
are you kidding? We're playing cards.
On satellite or on, you know, Sirius, I listen to Stern every morning.
Here they are, ladies and gentlemen, the Whack Pack jury. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Hi, good morning.
Hi, Howard.
Hey, guys.
Howard.
I could spend hours just listening to the Whack Packers. You know, I didn't care about the other stuff. Like, I didn't care when he bitches and moans and cries all day. I don't want to listen to that. But when he is interviewing Whack Packers and doing whatever, it's the greatest radio ever. So between Stern, between Steve Dahl, between, you know, the Mike Norris of the world, I knew that one of the things that differentiated us was that, you know, we didn't give the same bullshit content that everybody else did.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Mark Ames.
And I'm Erin Burnett. And we have several big stories on the radar right now. The jobs number coming in mixed. 244,000 jobs created, unemployment rate ticking up.
Yeah.
Do you still keep in touch? Has he told you that he's
getting out of gold now? I have no idea. It's been 31 years ago, so I don't have a... You might as well ask me about my first wife. You know, I'm not in touch with her either.
That's Motilal Oswal Securities. Manish, good afternoon. Thanks for taking out the time and being with us. So it's been a real wild ride for the market past 1 week or 10 odd days. What do you make of things as they stand right now?
We gave our own version of what we thought finance should look like, and we also made it personal.
So now, let me recap some of this stuff so we can make it all make sense for my mom, Tony's mom, Sara's mom, and Vanetta's mom, okay? Only if you're bullish. We're not making a judgment call on tastytrade whether we're bullish or bearish. We're just pointing out that if you were bullish on RIM, this is the best way to play it. If you were bearish on RIM, you did the exact
opposite. Hanging out with Sammy Hagar, getting probed by aliens, and you're bullish on RIM, This is the trade for you.
But if you're bearish on
RIM. We have to figure out where we're going to go. We don't know anything about production. We don't know anything about TV or radio. Media is new to us, and marketing was not our strength. But we figured if we could teach ourselves technology, we could teach ourselves media, and we go that way. We just started to assemble a team of people at that point that I trusted, that I thought could handle different roles. Key for me was bringing over Beth.
The first thing Tom asked me was, hey, you gotta go find a recording studio. It was just that blanket, like, we gotta get a recording studio. And I said, sure, I'll figure it out.
He wanted to do something that was audio only. He loved Howard Stern. He's like, it's gotta be kind of Stern-like or whatever. The first one I remember looking at was CBS. In the Loop. We went over there, Tom looked at it. He's like, I love the location. It's too big, we only need 2 rooms. We're like, 2 rooms?
After we saw it, we went down, we were on the sidewalk. He said, what do you think? He's like, all I care about is what do you think? What do you think? Should I take it? And I said, no, don't take it. He's like, okay, we won't take it, forget it. And I was like, whew. So after we looked at John Hancock, we talked to another friend of ours and we got another location. It was actually a current recording studio. We go into the place, Tom kind of just doesn't say a word. He just looks around and shakes his head. Tom said, look it, you take the keys, you leave them here and you walk out the door. He's like, you want everything? He's like, I want everything. I want the things on the wall. I want the CDs over there and I want that grand piano over there. He's like, I want everything as is and you can just leave.
Yes, 62 West Huron on the third floor inside of the old hip-hop studio. Vanetta always likes to tell the story. I had no idea what to expect, and a bunch of you goons are sitting in the room looking at me, trying to think if I'm funny or not. You know, I'm like, that was the worst interview ever.
Vanetta Logan, Michelle Obama skit.
Oh yeah, welcome to Ladies First, a show about women's issues and relationships. I am your host, the first lady, Michelle Obama. Can I get a what?
So I got a call back. So I go back to the hip hop studio, we're sitting around the fireplace, and this is where Tom becomes more prominent. He says, look, we know that you're all comedians, we know that you're all supposed to be funny. He's like, but it's hard to evaluate each of you in that sort of context. As a good faith gesture, we're gonna give everyone here today $1,000. And everyone was just like, I'm sorry, what? And like, you could hear a pin drop. Like, I thought I had a stroke. I was like, I'm sorry, wait. Like, because that doesn't happen. Like, if you go on an audition and you get a call back, the company's not just like, yeah, we're just gonna give you $1,000. Thanks for playing.
original game plan for Tasty was going to be, it was all going to be comedians. And when they cross certain lines, we're going to find trade ideas and we're going to keep people engaged through some kind of comedic discourse. But we didn't realize that the comedians were actually weren't that funny. We watched too many movies of Mel Brooks sitting around with, you know, Carl Reiner.
Where did the word cheese come from?
Cheese came as a strange thing. In the land of Ur.
Ur.
Not Ur. Ur.
Oh, Ur. You are, right.
A farmer milked a cow, filled up a barrel, and forgot about it. 3 weeks later, he came by the body shop. Oh, yeah, and he opened the thing. He went, cheese, does that stink?
Yeah, we had to change. At the last minute, we had to change gears. We made a mistake.
The first attempts that we made were all based on the language around trading and how stupid they are. Iron condor, short squeeze, like really what to outside people like myself sounds stupid.
Hi, welcome to Yoga for Traders. Why don't we start nice and easy with spiders and diamonds? Real easy.
Shortly, though, you realize that it's not, that's not funny to the people for whom it's just like saying, you know, anything, any kind of like term of the trade.
Rise higher, ye Taurian markets, I will thee
ride. We have two very marginally intersecting Venn diagrams between traders and comedians, and we're looking for big reference points that can connect.
Hey, Mr. Sosnoff, trade man, trade a trade for me. I'm not trading and I need to know what you knew.
Fluid, Bernanke said it, so you've been told. There's no chicken soup for the economy sold.
And Ben Bernanke at that time was someone who was popularly known and was some, you know, was financial.
Monetary policy is not a panacea. ABC wouldn't want to be a monetary policy is not a panacea.
Alex, give us a little ding, will you please?
Got it.
Every time you hear that little ding, that means a new trade idea has come out. If you're
initially, we were trying to do like market-themed comedy or something. It was like Tony came in after they realized they needed to do a show about the market that Tom needed to be on, and that's what people wanted to see.
Your mom just sent an email. Tone, your mom. Don't change, Antony. Don't change, Antony. You're beautiful.
No. But there has to be that phone
when we're
call.
When we're starting Tasty Trade, you know, I kept saying, what are you doing? And in Tom fashion, you know, he would say something to the effect of, you know what, you don't want to do this. You're not qualified, you know, or, nah, you're happy here. You got a good gig, you know, just stick it out, you know, that kind of thing. Nah, you know, it's probably going to be big, but it could fail.
Well, when we were putting together all the people, CD said to us, we had taken Beth and Linda and Michelle and myself, they said, okay, that's enough. I said, you know, you can't have anybody more.
I'm telling you right now, I'll die here. You can't do this to me. You gotta take me with you. Whatever you're doing, you gotta take me with you.
They were getting rid of the education group. And I said, well, here's one thing. I could use Tony Batista.
When Tom finally said, you know, okay, I'll let you in on what I'm thinking about doing. You know, I got to go to 62 Huron. Like that was the Mecca. Okay, like I had made it now.
So what do you think about me asking Tony to come? They go, you can have him.
And he's talking about, you know, doing a media company. I can't even spell media, you know. So I can understand him, you know, not wanting me to be a part of this media company, you know?
Okay, looking at this picture again, you're quite a hunk back in the day.
and it's just a good picture.
I could see how he was interacting with Bat and with other people. And you know, just the ribbing style of, if you've ever hung out with a trader for 5 minutes, you're gonna get roasted.
My first major crush on a guy was Tony about 3 weeks ago when we formed this program.
When Tony and I got up there, all of a sudden, you know, we had 20 years of history together.
You know, if you're Tom's friend, he would do anything for you. He'll make you pay for it, like, you know, in one way or the other, whether it's just words, I'm not talking about monetarily, like in words or ribbing you or something like that. I mean, he's a big kidder himself. He's a He's a whack packer himself.
And I was like, that's what we need to be about.
I just wanted to know what was the craziest thing.
On the May 9th show, mm-hmm. Sara asks him a question about women, about getting a girlfriend, not getting a girlfriend. The idea about diamonds come up. And he spins around to you and he says,
over the top romantic like Tony. I don't sit out in front of their window, you know, with a mandolin, you know, singing, you know. Not a diamond buyer, that kind of thing. So.
Is that what he says? Is that what he says? What do I say?
Nothing.
Oh, all right. I think when we first started, like, you know, I didn't think he was going to come out of left field with something like that. I mean, you know, he's the one that drew first blood, right? So at that point on, I was like, oh, okay. Well, if this is how we're going to go, we're going to have a whole lot of fun here. I don't know if we're going to make any money. I don't know if we're going to have any legs in this business. But we just drew everything down. The gloves are down. And from that moment on, it kind of set the tone for like, oh, okay, I see how this is going to go.
So one of the things that has been important to me over the course of building tastytrade with this amazing family, we've all been together now for a couple decades. When you look at Tom and Scott and Woody and myself, it's important to me being a woman, a female in that lineup, not only for my three daughters, but also for the city of Chicago.
One of the women that worked for us said, you know, we'd love to have some women on this network. And like, where are we gonna find women that know trading and all this other stuff?
Liz and I were together on New Year's at a party, and we had a few cocktails, and she said, Jenny, let's start our own show.
We wanted to do a show live from the SIBO and how much fun it would be. And I had just gotten off Second City, so I was still kind of joking around. I kept being like, we can call it Liz and Jenny in the morning.
Meanwhile, I'm in this wine group of ex-floor traders. So I go to my next wine tasting. One of the guys at the wine tasting worked at Thinkorswim. And he was one of the Cullen brothers. And he said, have you heard of tastytrade?
Then she called me. So remember that thing we were talking about? I ran into some people from this wine tasting, and they found out that you went to Second City and that we were going to do a morning show. And they want us to call this guy Tom from the trading floor, Tom Sosnoff.
They are in your wheelhouse. You know, they're young, they're attractive, they can talk the talk. They're used to idiots like you guys. They know your whole shtick.
And then Jenny's like, no, I'm too busy.
On the side, she's contacting tastytrade and setting up an interview with us and tastytrade. And I keep telling her, you can go do it, Liz.
She's like, I'm too busy. I don't want to go. I was like, put a dress, put some heels on, put a smile on your face, and I'm coming to pick you up.
To get dressed up to come downtown for the thought of possibly having my own show seemed crazy.
I picked her up from her house.
I'm running late. She's waiting in the minivan, wondering where I am, and I'm late, as usual.
It literally causes me anxiety to be late. So she causes me a lot of anxiety.
We drive in her minivan from the suburbs to tastytrade, plan the show in the car, and do our makeup, and watch the market. So we pull up to the brownstone, and we thought, is this Tom's house?
We thought it was.
And we walk up, we really didn't think it was his house. And I don't know if we were running late. I'm usually running late.
Jenny's always late. I'm always on time, just a little FYI.
So we walk in and we're like, oh geez, you know, here we are. Sorry, we're in a personal fast market.
And we said, you're hired. We didn't even, there was no interview. It took all of like 12 seconds. They said, aren't we gonna talk about like money or anything like that? They go, don't worry about it, we'll figure it out.
And he's like, yeah, you got a show.
Show. Mom!
Hello, welcome to the Liz and Jenny Show. I'm Jenny, and this is Liz, and we are broadcasting live from Chicago on the Tasty Trade Network.
We are so excited to be here today. It is our first ever show. Jenny and I have a little...
We've been practicing for about 3 months. We did a practice the night before, and right after the show ended, what did Tom say?
His exact words were, you suck, she sucks, this set sucks, we're still going live tomorrow. Now, Jenny and I were very nervous. I'm going to tell you from my perspective, very nervous to do the show. She calls me on the way down, and she goes, I'm going to do something, just play along.
That decreases, but then you're long the stock. So I created the naked put dance. You got the P&L
oh
line.
Oh my God.
You got the P&L line. You got the credit. Stock goes down. So what? Then you're long the stock.
Oh my God.
Okay, come on. Put your iPad down. I remember Tom getting an email from someone who said, I don't know who these two girls are, Tom, but they know nothing about options.
And that's all we ever knew was options.
So I think that email fired me up so much, I was like, we gotta change our show. And that's when I came in with the naked put dance.
Because now we're long this time.
At a better price.
Now, I'll never forget, after the show ended, Linda was the producer at the time, and Linda was in the booth going, oh my God, that just happened. Oh my God, that just happened.
But hey, it changed our show. From then on, we became more of a fun, entertaining show and less of a teaching show.
Yeah.
Speaking of Tony, happy birthday to the bat. It's his birthday.
Happy birthday, Tony. Tony, we've got him. You know what? This is what we get to do for a live show. Tony, come here.
Come
here, it's your birthday. We want to give you a hug.
We want to give Tony a birthday hug.
We want to give Tony a birthday hug and kiss.
Happy birthday.
Come here. This is our birthday boy. Come here. You know what? I'm keeping you. You're sitting here. Come here.
Right.
On the side. You get to go through what we go through, okay?
Now you get to see what
this
we do every day.
This is Tony, and it's his birthday today. Actually, it's his birthday tomorrow. Are we talking?
Tim Knight, right from the start. Tim and I were friends, and Tim had, you know, we'd worked together back at Thinkorswim. Where do I start with Amanda? She was cute, you know, and it was like, you know, it was fun to see if there was anything there, if it could work, you know, as far as teaching her to trade. And then we had Chicago cops. They were the horseback riding cops in Chicago, and we tried teaching them how to trade, and then we had these kids on from a coffee shop that claimed they were anarchists. We had those guys on. I mean, we did some crazy, stupid stuff. At the time, I didn't know that Tasty was going to be my legacy. You know, like I thought Thinkorswim was my legacy, whatever. And so, you know, I didn't know if Tasty was going to work.
I would do this like free spirit stint for a little while where I traveled, collected my thoughts, whatnot, until my dad approached me in about August of 2011 and said,
we have an opening. There are two women here that are really strong, Beth and Christy, and you can learn from them. And I think they'll set good examples because they both work crazy hard and you'll learn from them. And she goes, well, I'll try it out, but I don't know.
I went in, I talked to one of my coworkers, and she made resetting someone's password sound exciting and sound like I was actually making a difference. 2 hours later, I'm like, sign me up, I'm ready to do this, let's go.
I heard, you know, the word butterfly around my house as a kid so often, you know, and I'm like, what is this butterfly? He's like, you know, sell the butterflies and buy the butterflies and the iron condors, and I'm like, are we like in some butterfly business? Like, I don't understand what this is. And I just remember when I started working at Tasty Trade, it's like, I'm gonna now know what a butterfly is.
One of the questions that we continually saw coming from customers was this phrase of where do I start? Where do I start? People that have this wonderful do-it-yourself string but come into a sea of information in the financial services industry as a whole, but even coming to the world of Tasty Trade, they wanted to know, where do I start? And that's when Tony V at the time, our executive producer, said, aha, let's do a show, where do I start? One that made all the difference was when we took Tom's daughter and put her on air.
Back for our first inaugural Where Do I Start?
We are so excited. Look at that little, I think that's you in that picture.
But when it came time to put Case on air, she was apprehensive.
I'm Tom Sosnoff. He's Tony Batista. This is our first Where Do I Start? And sitting to my right is my daughter, Case.
Hello.
Hello, Case.
Hello. Thought you're going to forget about me for a second.
No. We're not going to forget about you. I can't. You're the firstborn. Okay? You're the golden child. All right. You ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
We're gonna have some fun for the next 5 days. We are gonna.
There was an aha moment with that show of the combination of Tom and Case because she asked the questions that she so naturally had, and all of the customers that were watching were like, "Thank you so much."
And I just remember turning to Christy saying, "Please, please, no. Like, I don't want to embarrass myself on camera. Like, he's gonna." Make me do all these, you know, option strategies and trades. I have no idea what I'm doing, and, you know, math was never my, like, strongest.
Bluebird can kiss my ass!
We were just starting to make it. We were in Sagamond. At this point, we bought a building. We got legs. We got income. Things are working. And there's only maybe 20 of us or so.
Around senior year, my dad was like, hey, you know, you should come work here or at least consider working here. Well, the day I got here, Christy called me in her office and told me I was starting a show the next week. So that following Thursday, I started on a Thursday. The following Thursday, I was starting the show, Where Do I Start with my dad.
Nikki, we're back. First show, Where Do I Start? Bat versus Bat.
Big Bat, Little Bat.
Now, when we did Bat versus Bat, Nick has history with me. We have a father-son relationship, completely different than stranger. Like, we have so much background that when I would say to Katie, you know, you got to click on this one because it's the 30 Delta option, or whatever I might be saying. When I would say to Nick, you know, we should click on the 30 Delta, he'd be like, I don't think we should. You know, no, I'm telling you.
I wanted to get a couple more deltas than that. I wanted to get real directional.
Building what I wanna, innovate what I'm gonna. You can hate all you wanna, but you sold your pajama. Now I ain't a prima donna, but I built what I wanna.
Your legacy is trading, but you're an entrepreneur. So do you remember how that bootstrapping in America all came about?
Bootstrapping in America, sure. Jules and I have been friends since the early 80s. It's one of the first people I met when I came to Chicago. We stood in the pit together. We were friends in the 80s. In the 90s, Jules moved to LA. And, you know, we stayed in contact. We stayed friends. But when we were building tastytrade, he's like, I have an idea for you for tastytrade.
So I'm going out to Valencia from Sunset Boulevard in the city. And I stop at the Aroma Cafe in Studio City to get some lunch. So this woman comes up to me. She goes, I like your glasses. And I look up. And it's Mary Lynn Rice Cub from 24. When I looked up, I go, oh, I like 24. So I called Tom from my car, and I said, I have an idea.
You should interview some, you know, some CEOs, some founders of companies that are starting out, because, you know, you've done this experience, and maybe, you know, that'll be interesting for the viewers. It's something different than just talking trading all the time. And so I'm like, yeah, that's cool. My favorite ones would probably be, you know, the crazy chefs. You know, obviously, you know, Stephanie Eisard, you know, she's like one of my favorites. I mean, Rick Bell is telling stories about cooking for Clinton and Obama. I mean, those were great. In 10 years, we do about 250 a year, so about 2,500 bootstrapping segments.
And that includes Tom doing it in the beginning and Christy doing it the last 4 years.
I think that's the best answer.
Yeah, I just, you know, I want this to work so that, you know, our kids and everybody else can, you know, can keep pushing it forward for the next, you know, 30, 40 years. It'll be fun.
That's great. And we're all along for the ride.
Yeah.
Including awesome. The taste traders.
Awesome.
So good. Thanks, Tom.
Thanks, Christy.
Tom Sosnoff is a brilliant visionary. But don't tell him I said that. I think that when we look at what has happened over the same 10-year period in Chicago, and the tech community and the growth and the birth of 1871 being ranked as the number one global innovation hub. You have Tastyworks platform being ranked number one in just a few short years after launch. It speaks to the talent that is right here in Chicago, the derivatives capital of the world. Let's call it putting a win on the board, not only for as a female co-founder, but also for Chicago and throughout the United States.
There's lots of people with lots of money, but it doesn't mean anything to me. I think people that go out and make it themselves and build something cool, that's interesting.
Tom and I have never started a business where we've had an exit plan. We've always started businesses where we go, we want to do something super cool, something different. We want to push the envelope as it is. You know, we want to expand people's opportunities. And then something will happen.
Tom and I are constantly looking at and looking for deals to do. Well, over this past year, there have been a number of firms that have approached us. We're at that 10-year mark. It is a prime time, an opportune time for something to happen.
Over the last handful of years, Tom and Christy have met with a lot of different businesses that were interested. It really heated up over the last 6 months.
You know, Tasty's funny. Nobody approached us for 10 years. In the world of finance, the exchanges shunned us, the industry shunned us, and then somebody, you know, looked at our business once and goes, what the hell? What'd you guys build here? This is amazing. And we had, as soon as that word got out, we had five companies bidding for us.
There was another company that came into play, and it came in fairly quickly. We figured it out very fast with similar cultures, similar customer bases. This was the right organization for us at the right time. Tom and I had our first conversation with the CEO on November 5th at 6 a.m. Central. November 20th, we signed the letter of intent. And on January 20th, we announced our signing of the definitive agreement.
I know it's going to give us the ability to scale in a way that we couldn't have done organically, which is how we have grown the business.
But when you look at the next 10 years and you say, what does that look like for us? What does that look like for the customer? It's all going to be built around that customer experience.
What you want to do is give people a reason, a differentiator. Give people a reason to come participate with Tastyworks and Tastytrade.
So for me, all of that is around, you know, building cool things, of course, but also like just like the interface that has a curve in it. And if it allows them to, you know, get comfortable with something that has risk in it in a way that like eventually they will learn everything they can just do without it, I don't care. We can throw away that technology at that point.
So if we go out and spend a bunch of money to build really cool stuff for people, they're gonna wanna gravitate to us. People are gonna go like, well, wait a minute, I can trade here on a computer on my phone? That's so 2000s. That's so 2010. That's so 2020. I wanna be 2030. I wanna be 2040. I wanna be cutting edge. And Tastyworks, Tastytrade, IG, et cetera, cutting edge.
There are definitely two or three categories of experience visualizing trades that I think that we would try and push into in the next couple years. And once we do that, then all of a sudden, the content that is put onto the network, for example, the enriching ability to be part of a community and to have an opinion and to express it and to learn from other people, that's the goal.
It's not just content where you are a viewer, it's content where you are an active participant. And for me, with having kids that do play some video games, there's an interest in gamification. So for me, I don't get that part of it, the video games, but when I talk to people that sit there and they pay to watch these people play, I'm like, why do you do this? They're like, why do you watch the NFL? Why do you watch, you know, NBA? Why do you watch any of these things? Because you want to see people do things that you're not capable of doing, that they're better at it than you. And I think that's what creates a level of excitement with viewers.
I think everybody's looking for personal interaction with the world. The penultimate goal is some sort of avatar voice.
It's gonna make customers be not only experiencing what trading is like, strategy is like, it's gonna be in it. They're gonna be at the center of it. They're gonna be in an augmented reality. They're gonna be in the pits. They're gonna feel like Tom and Tony felt 20, 30 years ago.
What if we created a trading pit? Now I know trading pits are gone, okay? Why not bring it back? Trading pits worked. The markets, there's nothing better than a two-sided market. And the pits are where you get the best two-sided market. So why not, let's take VR, let's take Tastyworks out across the world and let people just participate in a controlled manner, but in a way that makes them feel fully immersed and again, get it back to that gamification. I'm not well enough versed in virtual reality to understand if we could create a scenario like this, but in my mind, what I think would be absolutely fabulous would be if you talk to a trader, somebody who's, that actually was on a floor, a trading pit, and Tom and I both traded in the OEX, and then you walked on the floor, there was just a roar. You walk up the stairs, because the OEX, you walked up to then come down into the pit, you walked up and you came down. Every single time I went in there, it was like a kid in a candy store. You just felt this energy. You could feel it. Like you could feel the screaming on your body. Adrenaline would start flowing. It was like, I'm back. You know, it's just the action, shoulder to shoulder, chest to back. I mean, jammed in like sardines. It was like, okay, here I am. I don't know how we could recreate that, but to create that environment in a virtual reality setting, game over.
I always wanted a Batista to be on the floor of the CBOE. When I bought my seat in 1987, the day of the crash, it was a turbulent time and it was weird, but shortly thereafter, I was like, wow, you know, this is my business, this is my home, and not only that, it's my legacy. Like, this is what's gonna, you know, define me and my family for all eternity.
I mean, the first things I remember about tastytrade and about being introduced to tastytrade was that it didn't seem very serious. It was in like an apartment building. There was like a kitchen in the middle, and you know, like they would do like skits and like, you know, have like the soda stream thing on there.
This is really important. You just ruined my iPad. Nice job.
So when Nick finally decided to come on, I mean, I couldn't be prouder. And who better to have at least that legacy and at least that business know-how of what we're doing than to have my son, you know, at my side. Nick went to school with Harold Ramis's son. I went to school with John Gotti's son. You know, I mean, like there's a, he's gotta do better than me. Like, you know, he just has to.
What are some of the most important lessons you think you've learned from working with your dad?
I wouldn't be here if I didn't have my dad here to teach me. I think it's a lot harder, obviously, to learn without, you know, having a hands-on teacher, but I think it was helpful definitely to have him, you know, as the hands-on teacher for me.
Doing the show with my dad is something really special, and that's something that a lot of kids don't get to do, regardless if it's trading, if it's a talk show, whatever, but just having that dedicated 15 minutes, it was a really special period of time and a really special opportunity for us to get to do that.
Well, the whole thing of Case working at Tasty was great because I think that's just cool. But it's just cool, like, you know, building something up together. That's really cool.
The first time I walked into the door, I looked over and I was being yelled at, not yelled at, but I was being asked loudly by Tom to get out of the shop. But that was the first day that I ever walked in that offices. And, you know, now 10 years later, we're doing content like that that's even better and cooler and bigger.
And you're running it too now. So now you're telling people to get out of the way.
Now I'm telling people to get out of the way.
Tastytrade has created that culture because of the people that are here. Because at the end of the day, everything is a joint effort. And I think that we have had and can continue to have that kind of impact going forward because of the makeup and the people and the mindset all around empowerment.
This place is a great education for technology and media. It was for me and for a lot of the folks that were here. Tastytrade and this model was way ahead of the curve of all the streaming stuff that now is everywhere. When we were starting this, that was bizarre and made no sense. Now you realize 10 years later, oh, that was exactly right. That was exactly where the world was going.
Look how I worked that in there.
That was great. You shill.
Beautiful. And that's kind of what, that's one of the reasons we built Tastytrade.
10 years from now, talk to me about Tom 10 years from now. If you wanted to build some cool stuff right now and have fun.
But I do plan to open an iced tea store. I am going to sell iced tea and toasts because it's been a lifelong dream. So I'm opening an iced tea store in my neighborhood that I can walk to.
How much longer do you give yourself doing this thing, going around being sort of...
Hopefully you'll enjoy listening to us for the next 7 or 8 years. We plan to be on for a long time.
I don't know. I never thought I'd be doing it for 2 years.
We're going to have a little fun for the rest of our lives.
Absolutely.
All right, we'll be back in 2 minutes. You're listening to Get Tasted. And it goes like this.
I think we're sort of pretty well set up for at least another year.
It's time to raise this interest rate roof. No easy way to say it. The economy is sick, kids. It's on the sick list. There's no quick fix, but some say Bernanke is the best to do it. But what it really needs is just rest and fluid. Bernanke said it, so you've been told. There's no chicken soup for the economy sold. Commissaries follow me from Java to Korea. But monetary policy is not a panacea. Monetary policy is not a panacea. Monetary policy is not a panacea. ABC-a wouldn't wanna be a. Monetary policy is not a panacea. What's a panacea? Something easy, financial antivirus to fix what's queasy. Like McCoy said to Enterprise, keeping Kirk healthy. In this economic exercise, I keep people wealthy. I'm nice and rich, I tirelessly toil. The potion that I pitch, it ain't snake oil. One day we'll recover, God will it. But for now, there ain't no economic penicillin. Monetary policy is not a panacea. Monetary policy is not a panacea. I spit these facts and figures like verbal diarrhea. Monetary policy is not a panacea. Damn it, I'm an economist, not a doctor. Bernanke, y'all.